Terence Malick's most recent project is The Tree of Life, winner of the Palme d'Or at Cannes and a project that he has been harbouring for a long time. Many could argue that he has possibly been building up to, with his slow evolution of films that predate this. As his movies progress, they get somewhat more soaked in his own style and themes. His debut feature, 1972's Badland, is by far the most easily digestible of all of his movies, and The Tree of Life being the most obscure. I enjoy Malick's work. He is one of the few directors that I actually get excited about each project that he does. His eye for beauty, his unique lethargic style, and his incoherent and surreal psychological form of storytelling to me is intriguing and gets your brain operating on a different level than any other filmmaker at this present time. But I can fully understand why many people would find this work tedious and very boring. To me, this is the difference between movies and films. Malick doesn't make movies, he makes films, an art form rather than a money generator. In fact, it was reported that some cinemas had to put up a sign warning moviegoers that they would not be refunded their money if they walked out of the theatre, so as to put them off in the first place. I suppose that, even though this is a Brad Pitt film, this is nothing like a Brad Pitt film that his fans might expect. The story is about a family, who we see through the eyes of a child, Jack, who grows into a man played by Sean Penn. Jack as an adult is torn, battling a conflict of personality within him that we see as deriving from the two very different influences of his parents, and the struggle to come to terms with the death of a sibling. His parents, Jessica Chastain and Brad Pitt, are both excellent, although I found Chastain's scenes to be far more exemplary than Pitt's, bringing to the screen a natural love for the children that could have been real. The children too were superbly cast. Young Jack, played by Hunter McCracken, brings such a tortured performance to his role. The second son, whilst not as much in the limelight as McCracken, is superbly cast and I felt bears a striking similarity to his on-screen father, Pitt. In the movie's opening scenes, we are described two forces, grace and nature, and through their description we can identify that the mother symbolises grace. She lets the world be, moves within it, not disturbing those around her, allowing her children to be children. Again, she is another female character represented by Malick as being caught up and entrapped in a man's world. The force of nature is the father, Brad Pitt, whose authoritarian discipline is destructive and violent in his selfish need to survive, demanding obedience as well as demanding love. He teaches them what he wants them to learn, allows them to speak only when he permits it. Jack admits he is more like the father, although he desires to be purer like his mother, and this is the torment he feels within him. Malick's strange use of disjointed editing and inserts of visually pleasing yet mentally perplexing images are all there intentionally, and he wants us to address them and their relevance. I sense Malick knows the meaning behind these abstract shots that flicker between the story and the flashback. They simulate the human consciousness, perhaps being as close to how our brain translates thoughts and memories as anyone has ever dared attempt before. Unfortunately, his visual poetry has the opposite effect on the majority of audiences. If you've been put off by Malick in the past, then I suggest you steer clear of this film, as he takes his constant theme of the material versus the natural to even more fantastic reaches. Special effects godfather Douglas Trumball of 2001 and Close Encounters joins forces with Malick to create some astounding and spellbinding visual effects of the cosmos, which act as bookends to the human story and Jack's emotional journey. You can only hazard a guess as to what these images signify, and I believe that it represents the mother's own method of coping with the death of a son, solidifying her role as Grace, accepting the changes of the earth and her place within it. These scenes place our minuscule and insignificant lives on the incomprehensible timescale of the universe, a visual treat yet mind-melting in its depth, and requires an intrusive amount of audience interpretation that many will feel put off by. These scenes, however, I found easier to comprehend than, say, the scenes at the movie's end of the figures on the beach, which feel like a form of heaven, or perhaps just a vast memory bank in which Penn strolls. Malick and production designer Jack Fisk, a collaborator who's been there from the start, had the run of the entire neighbourhood, with 50s cars and dressed extras routinely moving around at a constant, allowing Malick his impulsive freedom with his camera and actors. It's his style to film what he chooses whenever he wants to, letting the moment lead the way rather than the schedule of filming. Likewise, he instructed composer Alaxander Desplat to create this spiritual and soulful score before the film had been shot, which is the opposite method than would usually be practiced. But Malick likes to collect sound and vision and take all these elements into the editing suite and use them like an artist would use colours from his palette. Alongside Trumbull's amazing effects, the beautiful cinematography of Emmanuel Lubezki again becomes a centrepiece of the movie. This film is designed for HD and looks so wonderful on the screen that, regardless of the movie's slow pace, nearly every frame is delightful and awesome to view. Sean Penn had a dispute with Malick with reference to the relevance of his character, the older Jack, and says that he felt there was not enough explanation to his importance in the movie. But as I said, I feel that everything contained within the film is important to Malick's vision. It's part of the same story, the son's fight within himself, the cleansing of his soul and the acceptance of his childhood influences, both grace and nature, thoughts and memories brought back to the surface on viewing the planting of a tree outside his workplace in the modern day, and a link to his memories of the tree planted in his childhood. He's also just another branch on the tree of life. I love Malick's depth and thought-provoking storytelling, his astounding imagery and poetic editing, but if I'm honest, I like to be able to watch his movies in the comfort of my own home, with the ability of pausing to go and make a drink or to be able to converse during it. I feel that in a cinema I may get a little fidgety during some scenes and can understand why people wouldn't enjoy his movies at all or find them long-winded. That being said, however, I felt that on watching this movie I'd just watch one of the most important films of modern years. I think he's a worthy winner of the Palme d'Or, but I suspect that he will not be so readily accepted at the more commercial bash that is the Academy Awards. It won't be long before we find out. Well, that's about all I've got time for. Thanks for listening. Feel free to comment below, give us a thumbs up, and if you haven't already, please subscribe and check out the rest of my videos at my channel. Thanks very much. Good night.